following lecture was produced by Glorian Publishing, a nonprofit organization, and is one of hundreds of lectures freely available via download, podcasts, streaming radio, and transcription. These lectures range in topic and complexity in order to address the many needs of humanity. We invite you to browse our library of lectures, books, courses, and articles to find teachings that suit you. Through the support of donations, Glorian Publishing has published 40 books, hosts international retreats several times a year, offers free online courses, and many other valuable resources, available to anyone worldwide. All of this has been made possible by the financial support of listeners like you. Your donations make it possible for this free public service to reach thousands of people every day. To make a tax-deductible donation in any amount, even anonymously, visit GnosticTeachings.org. Now, with heartfelt wishes for the end of suffering for all creatures, we begin the lecture. May all beings be happy.
The Nyctimeron, part 2. This word comes from the Greek language, which means night and day. Nyctimero. In Greek, nikta is night, and mera is day. A day made of 24 hours, which, of course, if we look at our clock, we find that it is made by 12 hours. And the clock, which is a round, usually a round element with 12 numbers in this day and age, indicates, of course, these 12 steps that we have to perform, or that the Christ performs, in other words, within each one of us. Because this is the main point of the Nyctimeron, to comprehend that the one that is doing these steps is the Son, the cosmic Christ. Because if we see the Sun, we see how it, in relation with the rotation of the Earth, it travels around in 24 hours. That's why in ancient times you found also these ancient clocks, which are always circular, with certain element in the middle, in order to point the shade and the light. So in those ancient clocks is how you can see the meaning of the Nyctimeron, because you see the light in one side and the shade in the other. And by looking at the shade of this instrument is how you guess or understand the day or the hour of the day. But of course, in the esoteric doctrine, this device or this Nyctimeron implies a lot, but always related with the light. Remember that the Lord incarnated in the Master Jesus said is written in the Gospel of John. I am the light of the world. When you read this, of course, it is written in Greek. But remember that Master Jesus of Nazareth, who represents the cosmic Christ, who is an incarnation of that light, brought into this planet the doctrine of the cosmic Christ, in order for us to understand the steps to follow for the self-realization of our being. And he, of course, spoke in Aramaic or Hebrew, if you want. And if we translate I am the light in Hebrew, then we say Ehyye Haor. Or is light in Hebrew. Haor means the light. But Ehyye is precisely the mystery here. Because this word Ehyye is precisely the name or the word that Moses heard from God when he, talking to God in the Mount of Sinai, asked him, what is your name, in order to tell those to whom you are sending me, if they ask for your name? And then God answered him and said, Ehyye Asher Ehyye. I am the one that I am. So it's repeated. That's why in Kabbalah, when we go and point Ehyye, we point at the first Sephirah of the Tree of Life, which is Keter. Keter is that point that emerges from the unknowable divine and is represented by a crown, because Keter means crown. That means a shiny element above the head. That's why when we refer to Keter, we refer as light that emerges, a point emerging from the space. That's why he is represented by the letter Yod, which is the smallest letter in the Hebrew alphabet, which is just a dot. That dot is precisely that light that emerges from the unknowable. That which is around that light is the darkness. But that light is only the end of a ray. And that ray is what we call the Ein Sof Or. The Ein Sof Or means the limitless light. It receives many names in esotericism. We call it also the solar absolute, or the solar abstract absolute, to indicate that that or that we are naming here, which is light, is solar. When we talk about the seven cosmoses, the first cosmos is the proto-cosmos in Greek, first cosmos, and is related to the Ein Sof Or, to the solar absolute. Within it, we find that we call the worlds or the planets of Christ. Planets, of course, we call them, because there are many. But if we call them stars, it's also the same. The planets of Christ, because within it or within them exist eternal, perennial nature, which is immortal. All the beings that dwell within those planets abide within this happiness, eternal happiness. Those planets of Christ belong to the protocosmos, to the ends of or, cannot be found with the telescopes, because they belong to the seventh dimension, which is the unknowable, the zero dimension. You see, the seventh dimension is divided into two parts. One which is unknowable and the other which is knowable. The unknowable is the uncreated light, that light that we said is the Ein Sof Or, which is the Christ itself. And the knowable is that we are talking here, which is called crown, Keter. In Christianity, Keter is called the Father. We, the Gnostics, we call him the Father of all lights, because he is united to the Ein Sof Or, which also receives the name of Glorian. So that Glorian is the Christ that divides itself into three aspects that in Christianity are called Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Of course, they are not persons, but forces of the light. In Kabbalah, you call it Keter, Chokhmah, Binah. Chokhmah means wisdom, and Binah means understanding. Sometimes they say it's comprehension, and other times it says intelligence. So if we call it Binah, intelligence, and Chokhmah, wisdom, but above them, the crown, three lights, or three suns, S-U-N's, that represents that light that we are talking here, which we in Greek is called Mera, which emerges from the night, as we explain in other lectures. It is written in the book of Genesis that in the beginning, that Spirit of God was moving upon the face of the waters, and there was darkness upon the face of the abyss. Darkness. And then Elohim said, let there be light. So that light is Or, is a Christ. But as you see, it emerges from darkness. And how do we call that darkness in Gnosticism? We call it Ein Sof. So the Ein Sof is a number 12. If you count the 10 sephiroth, or spheres of the tree of life, then above the number 10, which is Keter, you find the Ein Sof, which is the 11th. And then the Ein Sof Or is the 11th, and the Ein Sof is the 12th. If you see, both names are similar. The only difference between the Ein Sof and the Ein Sof Or is the word Or, which means light. So the Ein Sof is precisely that eternal darkness, which indeed is like a kind of light that for us is darkness. It's like when, for instance, somebody put a light in front of your eyes, very strong light, and then you dazzle. you cannot see that light, and you see like darkness because it's too much light in your eyes. So that's what is the Ein Sof. That is what is called dark light. Or uncreated light. But from it emerges Christ, which we call Or. That's precisely the solar absolute. So Christ is a Greek word. This is related to the fire, to the light. So when we Gnostics address the Lord, the Christ, we know that is that light that emerges from the Ein Sof and that forms a universe within that unknowable abstract space which is beyond the universe and form a universe which is filled with eternity. There are beings, of course, that dwell there in that Ein Sof Or. And physically, the Ein Sof Or has a physical body. And this is precisely what we have to understand. The physical body of this Ein Sof Or is any sun of any solar system. This is what we have to comprehend. That's why the Lord Jesus said, I am the light of the world. Because that light is Christ. People used to read that in the Gospels and to think that is the physical body, the personality of Jesus of Nazareth, who is saying, I am the light of the world. And it's precisely the big mistake of Christianity, thinking that the personality of Jesus is the light of the world. If we think Jesus as a bulb of electricity, as the electricity that shines during the night, we understand that the light, the electricity that goes through the bulb, is not the bulb, but shines through the bulb. So that electricity is Christ. So Christ is an energy, as the electricity is an energy, and shines through those bulbs which are ready, which are prepared to shine. And that is what is called in Greek doxa or dexa. There's a word called heterodox. Heterodoxia. In English is, for instance, the church, the orthodox, that's the word. Orthodox is the word in English. Thing that in Greek is, when you bring from Greek into English, is different, right? Orthodox. Ortho means straight. And doxa, or dox, is translated as glory. But it's also insight or apprehension of something. Sometimes it's like belief, they say. Or like on this comprehension of something. When you get it, you get the doxa. But that doxa in Greek means, most of in the Bible, when you read doxa, means glory. And they don't understand why they, in this day and age, put glory instead of comprehension of, or believing, or insight, or apprehension of something. Ortho, of course, is straight, the truth. So when you said, I am in the orthodox religion, means in the straight, the right one, that understand the doxo, the truth. right? Or the way in which the truth is comprehended, that is doxo. So, of course, from that point of view, each one of us has a different doxo or doxa, different way of apprehending things, which we will say different glory. And this is precisely the point here to understand, because the four Gospels are written in Greek. And when we go into the Nyctimeron, we go into Meta, into the light of Christ. And we understand that there are different type of bulbs through which the light of Christ shines, different voltages. So the comprehension of the light is different in each one of us. But among those masters, like Jesus, like Moses, like Krishna, like Buddha, that reach the perfection in their own level, that voltage is called objective reasoning. The way in which we reason with light, with intuition, with Christ. It's not this reasoning that people use in this day and age that is subjective, based in the five senses. So this type of reasoning is just subjective, intellectual. The intellect that we are talking here is enlightened intellect by the electricity. Means that the Lord is giving you a type of reasoning in which you understand life and the universe in different levels, according to your own level. This is precisely the only reason of existing. Because when we go into the 12th eon, which is the Ein Sof, which is that darkness that we're talking about, all of us have a part of it. Meaning that physically here, we are in the very bottom of the tree of life. Because all of us are divided in the same way. So if you see the tree of life, Malkut is precisely the very bottom. This is what we are here. You are sitting there, I'm seeing you physically. That's your Malkut, your physical body. But within you have a vitality. Your physical body has a vitality that is called Yesod, the foundation of life, or your physical life. Now if you go deeper, you find your emotions. You cannot deny you have emotions, feelings. That is called Hod in the tree of life. Then you go deeper within yourself, and then you find your thoughts. That is called Netzach, the mind. You cannot deny that you have mind, feelings, and energy of life and physical body. Because you think, you feel. But the only thing that you can see is Malkut, the physical body. Now, beyond the mind, we find Tiferet. That is what we call consciousness. The way in we apprehend, you see? Apprehension, that we're talking here. The way when you understand things with your consciousness, beyond your mind. When you have some hunches, that is Tiferet, intuition. I feel something, you said, but I cannot understand mentally. And that's why in Tiferet, in Kabbalah, is where you find the sun. Because if you investigate what is the planet related with Tiferet, you find the sun shining there. And that's why it is written that the Lord, the Christ, the solar light, expresses itself through us, through the heart, which is the altar of our soul, Tifereth. So the way of comprehending the knowledge, the understanding, the doctrine, is related with the heart. Christ gives you in the heart that comprehension. He is that solar force that is related with your soul, which is your will. That's why we said Tifereth is willpower within you. And if you go deeper, then you find your Geburah, your spiritual soul, which is something beyond, a kind of spirit, soul, or consciousness that you have to meditate a lot in order to grasp, in order to get the knowledge, in order to receive your own particular light that your inner monad has. And beyond Geburah is your spirit. You see, spirit is beyond the spiritual soul. So you know that we have spirit, but don't mistake your spirit with your soul. Soul is one thing and spirit is another. Spirit is. And a soul you build, you developed, spiritually and humanly speaking. Now, beyond your spirit is where we find that which in Christianity is called Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Keter, Chochma, Binah, the three lights of the Lord that we call the Glorian. The Holy Spirit is the number 8, Chochma is the number 9, and the Father is the number 10. Each one of us has his own Holy Spirit. Each one of us has his own Christ, his own Son, S-O-N. And each one of us has his own Father, which is the Father of your own spirit. Now, beyond that is the Ein Sof Or, the unknowable, the light of the unknowable. And deep down there, we have the Ein Sof, which is that star that abides within the unknowable, which is the very root of all that which in Kabbalah is called the tree of life, the parts of the being. All those parts manifest in different levels, as many people are in the world, as many plants are in the world, as many animals are in the world, because if you investigate every plant, every animal, every mineral has the same division. Obviously, we are higher because we are in the human level or intellectual animal level. But every single unity in the universe has this division. And this is what we have to understand and to comprehend. That what we call the ray of creation is that light that descends from the Ein Sof down to Malkut and even further into the world of Klipot. So, to understand this is precisely basic, because this is how we are. That's why when we talk about the 12 hours, the Niktimeron, you have to visualize that we are talking about Malkut, Yesod, Hod, Netzah, Tifereth, Geburah, Chesed, Binah, Chochmah, Keter, Ein Sof Or, and the Ein Sof. This is how in Kabbalah are named. The 12 Sephiroth, 10 manifested and 2 unmanifested. Those are the 12. Because the whole work is precisely to enlighten all of that within each one of us. You are, or as Keter said, Eheye, I am. Asher Eheye, I am the one that I am. This is your inner being, which is beyond your mind, beyond your soul, beyond your spirit. It's the first manifestation of your star. But I am wants to know himself. Because this is precisely the point here. We don't know ourselves. We enter into this path because we are ignorant. We say we are in nixta, night. And God, according to the book of Genesis, took the light from the nixta, from the night. So I am a night. So how do I take the light from this darkness in which we are sunk? That's the point. Knowing that the Lord emerges from the darkness, we said, well, the Lord is Christ, is the light. Because he said that, I am the light of the world. And the light of the world is the sun, the solar light. But in me, in my physical body, Malkut, we have, of course, that light. Because Malkut, in Kabbalah, is called the West. And Tifereth, where the sun is shining, is called the East. And why this physical body, Malkut, is called the West? Because all the forces of the Tree of Light that emerges from above, as you heard, finally enter into Malkut. That light that we call Christ sets in Malkut, which is the West. Enters into your body, sits into your body, penetrates into your body, goes into your unconsciousness, subconsciousness, unconsciousness. This is how the light of the Lord sacrifices itself deep down into us. And that's why Malkut, the earth, the physical body, is called the West. So in the West, the sun enters. But you see, when the sun sets, darkness comes. Because there is no more light. But the light is there. It's just that it's sinking into the matter. That light entering into the matter is precisely the light that we want to talk about. Because that matter is night. It's darkness. And that's why Malkut in Kabbalah is symbolized by a circle with a cross in the middle, which is precisely the symbol of Glorian. A cross with a circle. Because that cross is a symbol of the duality. Man and woman, positive and negative, father, mother, Adam and Eve. Because that force, in order to create, in order to multiply itself, needs to divide itself into two forces, which is the vertical line and the horizontal line. When we put it together, we form the cross. And when we spin that cross, a circle appears. That's why the cross or the square, which has four sides, But that fourth size comes from the union of two. That from the two emerges the four, which is the cross. And that's why in the cross or on the square, you find the quadrature of the circle. And from that spinning of that cross or square, you make the circle within which all geometrical figures hide. So within the man and the woman is the secret, the mystery of making that light to shine, which is the cross. That's why the clock is circular. And that's why it has 12 numbers around, in order to point the different steps that we had to follow within the 24 hours, which are 12 of light and 12 of darkness. But those hours, of course, are not hours of 60 minutes, as we think, physically speaking. The time is esoteric time. That is related with what we sometimes read in the Bible. That when Daniel, for instance, is asking an angel, when, oh my Lord, is going to happen these calamities of the time of the end? And somehow he answers, it will be in time, times and a half of a time. So when you read that, all intellectuals that are not having the sun, the light of the Lord in their heart, they are lost. What is time? And they speculate. Times, of course, one time, two times, and a half of a time. Only by walking on the path you understand. What is time, times, and a half of a time? It's related with the Enigmeron. But that time, times, and a half of a time is always according to our own level. We will say it in synthesis. Time. When you understand that you need something. First, that's time. Times, when you are looking for that you know that you need because you comprehended that you need it. That's times. Half of a time, when you really found what were you looking for. This is how it's in the simple ways. There are other ways, but to make you understand. But that is esoterically speaking. In order to follow the Nyctimeron. Because in the Gnostic Bible, Master Jesus of Nazareth explains that in order to save the souls, he moved the light or the mystery, the forces of all the universe 6 months to the left and 6 months to the right. When you read that, 6 months to the left, 6 months to the right, what is that? If you don't know Kabbalah, you don't understand. 6 and 6 is 12. It's always related to the Nyctimeron. But here he is dividing the clock in twice. 6 to the left, 6 to the right. And the clue, of course, on the number 6 is Tifereth. Because Tifereth, when you count the Sephiroth from Keter 1, Chokmah 2, Binah 3, Chesed 4, Geburah 5, and Tiferet 6. That's the clue. And why is Tiferet the clue? I repeat, because he is the number 6. In Tarot means the lovers. The lovers who are making the cross within the circle. And Tiferet is where the sun shines. Tiferet is that human soul through which the Lord Christ can shine. So the Lord Christ moves Tiferet towards the left or towards the right. It's so easy to see when you understand all the meaning of the Nictimeron. When the initiate incarnates the Christ, which is precisely the longing of all of us. Because this is precisely why we come into these studies. We want to incarnate the Lord. When we say we incarnate the Lord, I mean we want to incarnate the light, Christ, in our soul. This is a big goal. It's called the Venustic Initiation, the Great Path. So when the Lord incarnates in order to save that soul, because he is the Savior, that light can forgive your karma, can forgive your sins. But you have to work with the light, with the Nictimeron, in order to be forgiven. It's not like this in the millions of Christians in this age think, in this day and age, I repeat, that by raising their head, I mean their hand aloft, and saying, I believe in Jesus as my Savior, all his sins are forgiven. Or by going into with the priest and said, I confess that I made this sin, etc., etc. And the priest says, go and pray the Pater Noster, prayer of the Lord, and some Hail Marys, and your sins are forgiven. Oh, that's good, right? Everybody likes that. And everybody does it. And it's good, at least to do that. But really, your ego, that sin, is still there within you. Your sin is not forgiven. Or your karma, as we say in Sanskrit. For that, you have to incarnate the Lord in you. In a certain level of the Nictimeron, you incarnate the Lord. And then the Lord can move you towards the left or towards the right. What is the left? What is the right? Right? Is what you want to know. This is the tetragrammaton, the pentagram, the symbol of the Lord. A symbol that is being used and abused by Hollywood and many other people there in the internet. They use this symbol, but they don't know what they're using, what they're doing with it. You know, it's a very ancient symbol that symbolizes the Lord Christ in esoteric terms. Because all that is in there is sacred. In the right of the tetragrammaton or the pentagram, you find the word Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh, which in English is translated as Jehovah, the name of God. And in his left arm is written Adam, made into the image of God. So Adam, Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh, means the Lord, which is made unto the image of the Unknowable. But here you find precisely in the very middle of the pentagram, the symbol of the sun in the right part of the chest of the pentagram and the symbol of the moon in the left. Right and left. And the pentagram represents, of course, the human soul with the Lord incarnated. When the soul incarnates the Lord, Christ, the solar light, it becomes a pentagram, a living pentagram. Jesus was a pentagram. Moses was a pentagram. Krishna was another pentagram. And any initiate that incarnates that solar light becomes a pentagram. And it's simple to see it when you see that the men of the Zohar that you find here is another pentagram. You find the men of Zohar looking in the infinite. In his chest, you find the galaxy, the 12 constellations. In his waist, the solar system. And he is standing over the earth, 1 foot on the water in the ocean, and the other foot on the land. That is the gigantic symbol, which is called Adam Kadmon. And of course, it's a pentagram too. The arms, the two legs, and the head. Same symbol. And of course, in order for us to acquire the self-realization, we have to realize and to awake. As we see here in this physical world with our eyes, and we see trees, birds, people, things. And we go into a telescope, we see the planet, the stars. In the microscope, we see the small thing with our eyes. In the same way that we see here, we also must see the other four, or the other three spaces that you see here in the men of the Zohar. Because the bottom space that you find, which is the fourth space, where the man has his legs in the water and the other in the earth, that's called Asya. The physical world in which we are. But above, there are already three spaces. This is how Pisisophia called them, three spaces. The space above, where you find the head of this man, is called first space. Then the space of the chest is called the second space. And the third is called the third space. But as you see, the third space, which is a little bit above the fourth, which is us, the four, the matter, is related with the solar system. In any solar system. Above it, we find the galaxy. And above, the infinite. This is how in Kabbalah you synthesize the three spaces. When you talk about the physical matter, you form four. Because always the circle with the cross in the middle symbolizes the four manners in which God shows life or emerges in the universe. The infinite, the galaxy, the solar system, and finally the earth. Four. In Kabbalah, we call that Aziluth, the infinite. Bria, the world of creation, the chest. Yetziah, the world of formation, the waste, and the earth below, Asya, the world of matter in action. So we have to shine, we have to acquire glory, we have to acquire comprehension, insight of these four worlds. Everything is related with four. That's why the name of God is Yod, He, Vav, He. Tetra, four. Tetragrammaton, four. That's why the year has four seasons. Spring, summer, autumn, and winter. That's why in Kabbalah we talk about four elements. Fire, air, water, and earth. We know that, physically speaking, there are many elements. But in Kabbalah, we always synthesize four. And based on that, everything is synthesized. And you have to use your heart in order to see it. Because the light that we are talking here is within the water, is within the fire, is within the air, and is within the earth. The fire, the light within the earth, sulfur. You can burn sulfur and then you have light and fire. You want light from the water? Well, the Niagara Falls gives a lot of light, electricity. It's coming from the water. And you know that from the air also you can have electricity. So you can make light, electricity, from the four elements. Actually, right now, I'm using electricity from the mineral kingdom. I'm using a battery in this microphone that I have, and then using the electricity of the Lord in order to communicate. So the Lord is fire, is light, within any element, in Asia, in the matter. But it's in the center of any solar system, because the Lord shines from the sun, utilizes the sun as a vehicle. Any sun, physical sun, in the infinite space, we will say is like an atom or a molecule through which the light of the sun shines. And this is precisely the meaning of all of this mystery of the Nictimeran. Because when you find the carbon, the charcoal, it's black, right? It's like the darkness. It's very black. But if you light that charcoal, fire comes, that's the Lord. That fire that comes from the charcoal is solar light that was encapsulated there through millions of years. What is the petroleum? It's also the same solar light through many millions of years and different layers of the earth. And now it's being extracted in order to utilize it as a fuel and in order to pollute also. Because there are many other ways to extract the solar light, not only for petroleum, that is a very lower way. Why? Because the doxa of the intellectual animals of the earth are very low. They don't know how to take the solar light from other elements in order to not to pollute the other kingdoms. There's a mystery. So, of course, orthodox, straight, shiny. If we take doxa as glory, as they translate it in the Bible, glory, straight glory, we will say, the orthodox, the straight fire, the straight energy of the element is the fire, is Christ, is the light. So Christ is everywhere. When the volcanoes are erupting the magma, the lava, that's the Lord coming from the very center of the earth into the surface. And remember, it's written, the Lord will come as a thief in the night. But people are expecting a man, a personality, coming in the clouds. The Lord is the fire. It is a solar light. In the time of the end, the Lord will burn this planet, this humanity, in order to create new life. You remember that the fire, when burning the forest or certain fields, after that flourishes. New thing. Same will happen with this humanity. Remember that the Lord is not a person, it's energy that we can get, that we can nurture if we know how. If we know the mystery of the Nictimeran. That's why in each one of us we have to develop that glory. Each one of us has to develop his own glory. And this is precisely what we have to understand and comprehend when working with the Lord, with Christ. What we want is to be glorified. And we will be glorified if we incarnate the child the sun in us. This is how it is written. We've placed there a quotation of 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 39 to 58, written by this great Kabbalist, named by the Bible, the Apostle Paul, who was a Jewish rabbi that knew very well what he was talking about. He's the one that talks about the Nictimeron and how you developed in yourself if you know how to handle that light. Paul of Tarsus always speaks about the inner Lord, the inner Christ. He says, for instance, in the 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 39, he starts saying, all flesh is not the same flesh, but there is one kind of flesh of men, which is the earth. Another flesh of beasts, which is the fire. That's the symbol in Kabbalah. When we talk about the beasts, like the lion, for instance, like the tiger, it's a beast related to the element fire. Another of fishes, which is, of course, related with the element water. And another of birds, which logically is pointing at the air. So you see there how Paul of Tarsus starts talking about the four elements related with the flesh. Because our flesh is precisely where our aura goes out from, which the aura goes out. When you are very psychic, you can see that light shining around you. Actually, in this day and age, the Kirlian camera is photographing the aura of all matters. But there are people that, when they develop the sixth sense, clairvoyance, they can see that light. But that depends on the type of matter that we have within. Not only physical matter, but also molecular matter and atomic matter related with the protoplasmic bodies that we have within. Mind, feelings, that is protoplasmic, inside, because the physical is cellular. So you agree that all flesh is not the same flesh. Fish have different flesh that allow them to live in the water. The salamanders can live in the fire because they have a type of flesh that allows them to live in the fire. The birds can fly because they have that flesh that belongs to the air. And we belongs to the earth. But of course, continues Paul of Tarsus, there are also celestial bodies, which are called divine bodies, what we call causal bodies, and bodies terrestrials. So when we said embodies terrestrials, he is related whether from the earth, water, fire, or air, which we already, that he already explained in the first verse. Of course, he is directly talking about Tifereth, the causal body, the human soul united with the Lord. Those are celestial bodies, because everybody wants to incarnate the Lord. Everybody wants to receive the Lord in their heart, but you cannot receive it if you, first of all, do not create the causal body. You have to create the causal body. The body divine. This is how the Bible called it. When you create that, and then it says what Paul called the heavenly bodies. related with the human soul. And he says, but the glory of the celestial, which in Greek is called espuranios, or divine, is one. When you said glory, remember that we stated that glory means insight, apprehension of the light, comprehension of something, which is through intuition. That's the glory. This is not like people think, oh, that body will shine different than this other one. Because this is what commonly people think. The glory of the Lord, of course, is very strong, but the glory of above is not that strong. It's very low. But when we talk about glory, which is doxa in Greek, it means the way in which you apprehend the doctrine, the knowledge of God within you. When you hear people talking about the Bible and showing you the Bible and say, this is what is written, if you enter into my sect, then you will be saved, whatever, that is their glory. Meaning, that is the way in which they understand that. But you said, no way, I cannot receive this doctrine or this way in which this people is teaching me, because I see that it's very poor, it's very shallow. Why? Because your glory is different. The way you're understanding things, your doxa, is different. So when you enter and you receive the Lord, which is Christ within you, then your glory changes. But according to the nyctimeron, which is the path of perfection, that glory is changing. If you annihilate your ego, which is darkness in you, you take more light, you take more glory. And the glory shines within you by comprehending the Lord, because that's the path to comprehend yourself. This is called self-realization. You see, the being is the being, and the reason of the being to be is to be the same being, but that being doesn't know himself. In order to shine, he needs to know. And that's precisely, this is the path of Gnosis, to know. But people think that to know is to read the Bible by memory, or the Quran by memory, of other books by memory? No, that is not to know. To know is to know yourself. Homo nocete ipsum. That's precisely a statement in Latin, in the old temple of Delphi. It means, man, know thyself, and you will know the gods and the universe. You see? That's the nyctimeron. The universe is related to the four worlds of Kabbalah. So when you know yourself, you know that the tree of life is yourself. The ten sephiroth and all that. Then, that there to the Ein Sof. All of us have those 12 parts. So if you know those 12 parts, if you enlighten with the light of the Lord those parts, then you will know yourself. And because those parts are connected to the different parts of the universe, you will know the universe and the beings that dwell in the universe. So man, know thyself, and you will know the universe and the gods. Homo nocete ipsum. That implies to know. Gnosis. So you have to unite, to merge knowledge with the being. Or in other words, talking Kabbalistically, you have to unite the tree of life and the tree of knowledge. That's why the Master Samael on the earth states that the book of Genesis talks about two trees, the tree of life and the tree of knowledge. In order to self-realize yourself, you have to unite the two trees in one to acquire knowledge. So when you acquire knowledge, it's not knowledge of somebody else. It's knowledge of you. Knowledge of your being. So this is to know. To know yourself. And by knowing yourself, you shine. You have your own glory. And for that, you have to walk with 2 feet. You cannot jump in 1 foot. That's why we have 2 feet. You advance with the left, and then the right, and then the left, and then the right. This is how you walk. And this is how you walk internally too. Remember the pentagram. And one side is the sun, and the other side is the moon. The moon is the left foot. The right is the right foot, is the sun. The sun is called the good. The moon is called the bad. To understand how to work with the moon and with the sun is easy. Just watch the opera, The Magic Flute of Mozart. He describes there beautifully how to work with the 2 feet. The woman is the moon and the man is the sun. The queen of the night, which reflects the light of the sun. So we have to develop our glory. The glory of the celestial body is one, and the glory of the terrestrial is another. In other words, there is one glory of the sun, and another glory of the moon, and another glory of the stars. You see that? When you read that literally, you said, yeah, I understand. The sun shines in one way, the moon in another way, and the stars in another way. Easy, right? No, it's not that. It means that your soul, who incarnated the Lord within you, in other words, the bodhisattva, shines, has a glory, a doxa, in heaven. Because the one that incarnates the Lord is the soul. So that's the glory of the sun, Tifereth. And another glory is of the moon. And what is the moon? Well, the moon shines above the earth. You know that, right? During the night. We are the night. Because we are in darkness. But our mind is the moon. So that mind reflects the light of the sun, as the moon reflects the light of the sun. We see, for instance, the full moon, how it looks like a sun, but it's not a sun. It's just reflecting the light of the sun. Likewise, the mind. The glory, for instance, talking here personally, in my own case, I am shining now for you. I am throwing light to you. Well, that is the light, that is the glory of my moon, of my mind. My moon, my mind, is only reflecting the light of the sun, which is above me, inside, the Lord, Christ. That is superior light. So when we were, for instance, with the Master Samael on the earth, present with him, we see the glory of the moon, of his mind. But behind that was the sun in Tifereth, which is another glory. And it's precisely how the Master Jesus talked to his disciples in the book called Pistisophia. His disciples are in Tifereth, are the souls who are following the direct path, the path of perfection. So he talks to them in Kabbalah. If you read the Pistisophia in the beginning, he says, and Master Jesus didn't tell them the mysteries of the 24th mystery, or the first mystery, or the second space, the first space, and etc., etc., to his disciples. But those disciples are not in the physical plane, are in Tifereth, because that's the glory of Tifereth. And here in the physical world, the physical body, with his own mind, is trying to explain that with the reflection, with his moon. That's why it says difficult. when you hear a lecture, you are saying only the glory of the moon, of the mind, of that initiate. But it will be good if you develop your intuition in order to enter and to touch the sun of that initiate, which is not in the physical world, but in this, in his soul, which is Tifereth. So that is what it's called. One is the glory of the sun, and another the glory of the moon. Remember that Malkut is a physical body. And another glory is of the stars. That's another thing. It's beyond. Because Tifereth is connected to one star. That star is a star related with the constellations, the cosmos creators. The cosmos creators are channelers that channel the light of the Ein Sof, the light of the Ein Sof Or, and the shine of that channel the light of Atzilut, the father of all the lights. You hear, for instance, the great cosmos creators of the planet Earth are Gabriel, Raphael, Uriel, Michael, Samael, Zachariel, and Orifiel. Those are the seven spirits before the throne of God, called stars, the seven stars in the hand of the Lamb. The glory of them is even, you see, when I said glory, the apprehension of the truth, the apprehension of the light, the insight, the doxa of those cosmos creators is deeper. And in order for us to receive that light, we have to prepare into the niktimera, walking with the left, with the right, and with the right, with the left and with the right. When we walk with the moon in the left, is when we go and meditate in our egos. That's the moon, because the egos are lunar. But they reflect or they trap the light of the sun within you. Sometimes the initiate has to sink into the abyss in order to get the light from the abyss. Your abyss is your unconsciousness, subconsciousness, infraconsciousness. But when the initiate walk with the left, the Lord abandoned him. And this is when we are tried, when we are tested. Because when we are walking with the Lord in the right side, the Lord is with us. He's shining in us. But in the left, we have to go down by ourselves and to comprehend our demons, devils, defects, vices, in order to get the light. When we disintegrate an ego, then that part of the consciousness goes and unites with the Lord in the right. So that's why when the Lord goes into the left, he disguises himself and goes down into the abyss with us. But it's very difficult, because when we are in the abyss, in hell, in the inferno, we are attacked by our own demons, by our own defects, our own vices, our own desires. And what we want to reinforce by praying. That's why the Master Samael gave a lot of prayers, a lot of clues that we need when we sink into the abyss in order to snatch the light from the darkness. Because there's a lot of demons in the moon, lunar forces that we have to defeat. And this is how the initiate works with the left and with the right. In the right, he's dealing with sheep, good souls. And when he walks in the left, he's dealing with goats. So we need to learn, as Master Jesus knew, how to deal with sinners and how to deal with virtuous people. Remember that the Lord was always with sinners, because the doctrine has to be given to sinners. Sometimes the initiate remains long time in the abyss, and he believes that he is lost because he don't see the light. Too much ego. It's called the spiritual night. Master Samael talks about the spiritual night in one of his books called The Mystery of the Golden Blossom. Beethoven experienced that cosmic night. In each one of us too, in different levels. It's in which the initiate see himself lost in the abyss. It's related with that statement said by Jesus on the cross. From the sixth to the ninth hour, there was darkness on the earth. And Jesus exclaimed, "Father, Father, why are you forsaking me?" He feels abandoned. And this is precisely how the initiate feels. Sometimes you feel like that, yet you are abandoned. He says, "I am working in this path and I don't see anything. I don't see the light." So we have to develop intuition and to work with more faith, because this is how we are tested. Eventually, that night will end, and then we are going to enter in another day, because this is the path. Sometimes we are in the day, sometimes we are in the night. We are walking with 2 feet. We have to fight, as the Master Samael said in Pieces of Fear, against the forces of good and against the forces of evil, in order to go beyond good and evil. And those forces are within us. It's not outside of us, within us. And this is precisely the path. So, continue with the quotation. This says that one star, the star of one, the glory of one star is different from another star. Of course, if we understand that that doxa insight or objective reasoning is different, so also is the levels of resurrection of the dead. Did you hear about the resurrection of the dead? The resurrection of the dead means those that are working in themselves. When you die in some darkness, sin, defect, vice that you have within, something resurrects within you. So the resurrection of the dead is start in different levels. But in the beginner, is the way in which the beginner sits down, meditates, for instance, in his anger, or her pride, or his lust, or her laziness. So the beginner is there, and she comprehends. Comprehension means insight, means doxa. And you are developing understanding of yourself in the very orthodox way, because you are attaining the truth, the direct truth of yourself. That's called orthodox. And then you are glorified, you glory, you shined. So your glory is different. That glory shows through your heart and through your mind, through your mind, through your heart. So that's why it is written, the resurrection of the dead is different in each one of us. And according to the path of the self-realization, is how that glory will shine. In the beginning you said, "I don't understand, this is so difficult." Well, your glory is not at that level. But if you are walking, continue the path, and performing the 3 factors of the revolution of the consciousness, suddenly your glory will shine, will change. And you will reach that level and we said, "Now I understand." But then you see that still you can shine in different level. So one is the glory of Jesus. Another is the glory of Moses. And another is the glory of Samael on the Or. and the glory of Krishna. Every initiate has his own glory, his own reasoning, but objective that shines with the sun. This is what you have to understand. Every religion is good, because the glory of every religion is according with the one that found that religion. It is sown in corruption. It is raised in incorruption. This is what precisely Paul says. All of us, when we enter into this path, we discover that we were engendered through corruption. Because we know that lust is the orgasm, the spasm. And all of us are children of the spasm, of the orgasm, of fornication, as the Bible says. So we were engendered in corruption, but we can't develop through chastity in this body of corruption. Because this body of corruption, which is my physical body, has to learn, has to be in chastity. And through the incorruption, we learn how to go out. And that's why it's written. It is raised in glory, one is self-generated in virtues. It is sown in weakness, one is engendered by the devil. Weakness. The devil is the lust that we have within. One is self-generated by the Holy Spirit when one is raised in power. By chastity. Now, Paul talks about the natural body. What is the natural body? Well, in Greek, it's called soma psychikon. Psychikon means psyche, from the psyche. You have to understand that one start developing, creating another type of nature when one knows how to transmute the sexual energy. The astral body is the first body that is created. But before that body is created, of course, you have to fortify your vital body, which is called also psychikon. That's why people hear emotional astral body, the soma psychikon. It is raised a spiritual body, the soma pneumatikon, which is the mental body. So in certain levels, the mental body is called pneumatikon, because through it you can explain about the spirit, about the light. So there is natural body and there is a spiritual body. But you have to understand that those bodies are inside. We have to create them when we know the doctrine. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet, the seventh, the trumpet shall sound, and the dead, the psychological particles of God, shall be raised incorruptible. And we, as souls, shall be changed. Let me show you something here. Let's just... I guess that I went so far, right? But it is also written in the Bible. The first man, Adam, was made a living soul. Psyche, the soul. This means that the first Adam that you read in the Bible was made ethereal, astral, and mental. The four worlds, if you count the physical. That's called Adam, a living soul. And the last Adam was a quickening spirit, pneuma, which is called the causal body. So in other words, when somebody creates for his own or her own use. A solar emotional body, a solar mental body, and a solar vital body is an atom, a psychic atom, living soul. But when you reach and create the causal body, which is related with the spirit, to your monad, then you are spirit. Well, it says a quickening spirit. Because then you can see your glory shines not only in the physical world, but in heaven. And this is how you are being born in heaven. That is to be born again. So if you continue reading there, I am not going to do it in order for you not to get so tired. But in synthesis, we have to understand that the glory of the Lord shines, or the comprehension of what the Lord Christ gives you shines not only physically, but in your astral world, in your astral body, in your body of feelings, in your mind, in your soul, in your spirit. So the Lord is changing you. And for instance, right now, you are listening and trying to comprehend this knowledge. Or when you read the Bible, trying to comprehend that is written there. But you realize that your glory is not that much, and that you need to build more light. And that's the main point here. By building that light means changing your glory, a way of comprehending things. We start receiving the knowledge and comprehending things in a very subjective manner. But we want more light. So that light is within you. You have to develop by creating your existential solar bodies within you. Your astral, mental, and causal solar bodies. It's called solar because the Lord needs to shine within them. And then you will feel the doctrine. You will comprehend in your mind the doctrine. You will see with the light the symbols in a very intuitive manner, because that light will give you that and beyond. And that is developing or developed while you annihilate your ego, while you annihilate your shadow and make light within you. And of course, you walk with those 12 hours of the Nyctimeron in different levels. And that's why in this path it's necessary to memorize the 12 hours. It's not that much. So when you see the clock in the internal planes, you know what your shine, what your sun, S-U-N, what the Lord is telling you. Because the Lord helps any soul at any level. But remember that He shines in different levels. And the goal, of course, is to acquire objective reasoning in order to understand your God. But you have to have a vehicle for that. That vehicle has to be created. Or as Master Jesus said in the Gospel of John, you have to be born again in order to enter into the kingdom of heaven. The kingdom of heaven is related with the three spaces that we're talking in the first, in the beginning. Yetzirah, Bria, Atzilut, those are the spaces of the kingdom of heaven. We are in the very bottom, in Malkut, which is the physical matter. But let me just go to the very end of this quotation, where Paul of Tarsus explains about the physical body. And the very, I don't know which verse is, but it says there, now, this I say, brethren, he says, listen carefully, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God. It is very clear there. What type of flesh we're talking about here? The physical flesh. Many people in different sects of Christianity who read this verse, they don't realize that it's stating there that flesh and blood cannot inherit. The physical flesh and the physical blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God. They think that in the day of judgment, they will be raised from the grave with bones and muscles and etc. because they were believing in Jesus, because they were belonging to this sect or whatever. And they don't realize that it's stated that flesh cannot inherit the kingdom of God. We had to transform ourselves. Because he says, neither doth corruption inherit incorruption. Corruption, the body is made through fornication, because these bodies that we have were made through fornication. So how we think that with this body we will go to heaven? Many people think that. That some of, all of a sudden, in the day of judgment, they think that they will disappear. I see many times in TV or in the internet these videos of these people talking with another person, talking about, but this person that is talking with another person, it belongs to a certain sect of Christianity. And all of a sudden, disappears from the air. And says, why he disappeared? Oh, because he belonged to this sect of Christianity that he believed in Jesus. And the day of judgment is right now. So Master Jesus with his angels are taking every single one physically from wherever they are. And you see that one person is being interviewed and disappears from the air. Another is driving a car and disappears from the car. An accident. Another one that is very Christian, that believes in Jesus, is piloting an aeroplane. And it's taken out, so obviously the aeroplane crashes. That glory is really very dark. Yeah. The way of understanding, you see, the doxa. Because there are many sects, many religions that believe in different levels. What type of glory do we have? Or what type of glory is that to believe that we are talking here and because I believe in Jesus, suddenly I will disappear in front of your eyes because the yet day of judgment came to me. And because you are not in my belief, well, you are said, where is this speaker? It's gone. Right? Foolishness. I mean, it's so really funny. But this is the way many people think. That's their glory. It's like a match. The glory is like a match. Right? That you strike and quickly disappears. So we have to build our own glory that will shine forever. And then we have to comprehend and enter into these mysteries. And to understand that the flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of heaven. This is written. We have to work in order to gain the kingdom of heaven. In order to gain it, we have to build the solar bodies. And that is chastity. That is incorruption comes from corruption. But because as corrupted as we are given the clues for all of you to create what we need to create. For all of us to annihilate what we have to annihilate. And this is how from corruption comes incorruption. And how the dead resurrects. Because we are physically, spiritually dead. We want to resurrect into heaven. Well, we have to work very hard. We have to develop our own glory. Remember that the sun sets in the physical body. All the light of the cosmos is setting in our physical body. Do we need to shine? Well, make your sun rise. How does the sun rises? In the east, towards your heart. That's why when you see the sign of the pentagram, you see the sign of the pentagram in the middle of the pentagram? You have the caduceus of Mercury. In order for your sun to shine and to know how to walk between darkness and light, which is the moon and the sun, you have to ride your sexual energy through your spinal column. You have to know the path of chastity. This is how the sun starts shining within you. And don't get desperate. If in the beginning you see only a little bit of light, because sometimes in the horizon, when the sun is rising, there are a lot of black clouds. Right? Did you ever see that type of sun rising? That not always is very open, and the sun is shining beautifully. It's always cloudy, black clouds, and scarcely you see the sun there, but there is a lot of black clouds. I know there is experience when there is no clouds and the sky is very open and the sun shines beautifully, right? Well, listen, all of us have a lot of black clouds in us. Those black clouds are related with your thoughts, your mind, your ego. And even when you are working with this doctrine and transmuting your sexual energy, sometimes you don't see too much light, even though the light is rising there. But you don't see more light because you have a lot of clouds. That reminds me an experience that I have with the Master Samael on Veor. I remember that I was in this pool, and he was resting there, receiving a lot of light of the sun. And he called me and told me, "Do you want me to disintegrate a cloud?" "How, Master? How you want to disintegrate a cloud? Look at that cloud." And he pointed me to a cloud in the sky. "I'm going to close my eyes," he says, "and in 2 minutes, it's going to be disintegrated." I said, "Okay, I will see it." But since I always observe the sky, I know that the clouds dissolved by itself, you know what I mean, without the necessity of anybody. I said, "Whether he's tricking me or testing me here." I said, "Well, is it? That cloud will disappear anyhow." And then he says to me, looking at me, he says, "Is it disappearing?" And I said, "Yeah." And he says, "Well, okay, don't trick me," he says, "because I'm going to, that one is the one that I pointed, not this one." "Okay, yeah, the one that is disappearing is what you pointed me." "Okay." So finally, the cloud disappeared, you know, because they always disappear, right? He said, "Do you see the power of a man?" I said, "Yeah." But I understood that he was, the way in which he was talking in similitude, you know, the cloud, the mind, the thought, the ego. And he was doing it because he had the power to disintegrate an ego. But then I addressed him and said, "Okay, Master, I understand. You can disintegrate a cloud. The Lord can do it. But I want you to disintegrate for me all of those clouds that are there." And I point to the horizon. And there were like, I cannot tell you, but thousands of black clouds. Disintegrate that for me, please, I said. That's what I want. And then he said, well, that's too much power. Let us wait. Because I have to give the lecture anyhow, he says. And I cannot waste my power here right now with all those black clouds. I said, yeah, okay. But he, of course, understood my answer. And I said to him, because I knew that the Lord was within him. He said, well, if you want to really help me, this cloud really doesn't help me. Disintegrate all the black clouds that I have within me. This is what I said to him. And he understood. He says, well, not now, because now I am giving a lecture. Later on, we will see. All right. So see, this is how the master sometimes talked intuitively to his disciples. Thank goodness I understood the meaning of that at that time. But many other Gnostics that were talking to him, they didn't understand. And they knew that the clouds were disappearing by itself, so they were confused. I said, well, my master is trying to trick me, or what is this, you know? But there's the meaning. You know, in order for your sun to shine in your sky, in your own consciousness, you have to disintegrate all your clouds. But you cannot disintegrate all your clouds if you, you know, incarnate the Lord, because the Lord is fire, and he can do it, helping you to do it. And that's precisely the mystery of the Nyingtimerane. He does it in 12 steps. Don't forget that. Do you have questions? How is your glory? Is it shiny that you don't have questions?
It's hiding.
It's hiding, yeah? Yeah, the question is to talk about that we come from a star. That star, as I explained to you in the Tree of Life, is the Ein Sof or the Ein Sof. In the very depth of our consciousness, all of us have our own Ein Sof. That Ein Sof is a star. But it's a star that knows it needs to know itself. It needs to develop. And that's why that star throws his ray. That ray is they call the Ein Sof Or. And from that ray emerges all the Tree of Life. And finally, we are the end of it, physically speaking. Now, here, he wants to withdraw, to take the light back in order for that star to shine, to have his own glory. And that's precisely what we have to do. We are here in the very bottom, in the physical world. Sit down and know yourself. Start knowing yourself in the physical level. And little by little, you will go in other levels. And then your glory will shine. The one moment you will reach the Ein Sof again, to return to the source where you came from. And then your glory will be 100% bright. But right now, we are here. Don't think that we are up there, because you only hear about in the lectures. The only thing that we can see is this physical world, because our glory is very low. The question in the back?
When you say that Tiferet is the heart, what is thought? I thought emotions were the heart.
Well, when you point at the Tree of Life, you have to see that it is formed by three triangles. Keter, Chokhmah, Binah. The other triangle is Chesed, Geburah, Tiferet. And the other triangle is Netzah, Hod, and Yesod, right? We are at the very bottom of the physical body. We have three brains. The brains relate to Yetzirah, Yesod, the sexual brain, Hod, the emotional brain, in Netzah, the mental brain or intellectual brain, in your body. Now, when you talk about the second jungle, then you find Tifereth in the sex, related with your heart in Geburah and Chesed in your head. And then when you talk about the other jungle, you put Binah in your sex, Chokmah in the heart, and Keter in your head. But when we talk about all of them together, then Tifereth is a heart. By talking all of them together, when you see the imaginary man of the Zohar, Tifereth is a heart. But in order to understand the position of all the Sephiroth in relation with your three brains, put always every triangle in relation with your three brains. This is how you understand it easily. And then you understand why Tifereth, which is the heart, is related with the Yesod, which says you shall not fornicate. Sixth commandment. Chokmah is a heart, Tifereth is a heart, Hod is a heart. You see that? You see it with intuition. The tree of life is a hieroglyphic that you have to utilize with your heart, with your intuition, in order to understand it. Once you grasp that with your glory, you see, with your glory, not with your animal mind, because that's a problem. There are many Kabbalistics, intellectual Kabbalists, that take all of this with their mind, and that's wrong. The way to understand the tree of life is when you take it with your heart. And remember that in the heart, in Tifereth, is the sun. Shines your own glory of your own Christ shining through you. So that's why you had to pray. My Lord, you said, I am the light of the world. I am a world independently, physically speaking, psychologically, in a very rotten world. Very bad. Can you shine for me, please? Shine for me. Concentrate in your heart. Then the Lord will start giving you light according to your own level. Another question?
Yeah. Can you give a real life example of thinking with the heart?
A real life example of thinking with your heart. When you have hunches, you are going to do something and you have a hunch of not doing it or doing something else and you don't do it. Did you ever felt that? Mm-hmm. Did you ever feel that? Yeah. Hunch. That is example. That you feel to do something in your heart while your mind is telling you, no, don't do that. Better to do this. You know? And that's the only example that I can tell you, because there are more, but for that you have to develop your heart, your intuition. For instance, when I see, I'm doing super efforts here because with my heart, believe me, I see a lot. But when I give you to you and I see your faces, I see, my goodness, I'm trying to take that light into their moon to see if that light is reflecting. But it says, oh, it's very difficult. It's not reflecting, but I hope in the future, because it's recorded, you will reflect that light. You know, I hope you will reflect that. Remember that your moon is your mind, the heart. And it's difficult for the mind to understand what the heart understands. Another question?
Are you suggesting also that by waiting for the cloud to disintegrate by itself as natural, that this is an indication that the mind silences on its own?
The question is that. Is that when the clouds disintegrate by itself, is the mind by disintegrated by itself without any?
Is that an indication that the mind silences on its own?
Oh, indication that the mind silences by its own manner, by its own way? Yes, of course. If you don't pay attention to your thoughts, eventually those clouds, those thoughts will disappear and will make your sky very open. That's through way of meditation, of course. That's when you look of Samadhi. Samadhi is a very content with your own glory, with your own sun. But within the meditation, you find a lot of clouds. And you comprehend and disappear this cloud, and another cloud appears. And you keep saying, I want to see the sun. I want to enter into my ecstasy, into Shamari. And other clouds appear. And many clouds. So you have to be patient. Comprehension is what is needed in order for the clouds to disappear. Because this is precisely what you do when you meditate. Comprehension of what you see in your sky, in your own mind, in your own psyche, in order for the sun to shine. And to be patient. Another question. Well, the question is very long. But let me give you an answer, a concrete answer, in this way. To walk with the moon and with the sun, with the left and the right foot, is done through comprehension. Because the moon has to be full moon, or honeymoon. And the sun has to be shiny at the zenith, at the 12th midnight. Or midday, I mean. So that is to walk with 2 feet. To acquire comprehension. To overcome your ordeals when you are walking with the left. But when you are walking with the left, you are in the abyss. In darkness. Being attacked by your own demons. So then you have to comprehend your demons. In order to walk with the left. Because if you are just there, as you said, observing and whistling, doing nothing, you are not walking on the path of the Lord. In order to walk on the path of the Lord, you have to comprehend, apprehension, glory, doxa, insight. You have to be orthodox, right truth within you. Whether you are during the night, whether you are during the day. In the day, is easier because you have a lot of light, but in the night it's very difficult. That's called the spiritual night. You feel abandoned. You had to double, triple your efforts of comprehension. Remember, that's the path to know yourself. In order to know yourself, you have to comprehend yourself. To know yourself is when you watch your image in a mirror. And you see how you are. This is what James talks in one of his apostles. But if you watch your image in the mirror and you turn your back and walk away, that means that you are not walking on yourself, on your own image, in your own moon. Right? Because the moon is that image that reflects the light of the sun. So we are in the night now. And when you enter into your cosmic day, your sunshine, sometimes you said, well, should I remain here or should I abandon the earth in order to make more light? And that's the path of the Bodhisattva. You renounce Nirvana in order to go into the abyss again in order to make more light. And when you reach another level, you shine more, your glory is more strong. And you say, and then, I have to abandon now this glory, this level in which we are in this nirvana, and I have to go to hell again because I want to make more light. And this is how we're renouncing and going up, renouncing and going up, descending, is how you go, and finally you reach the absolute and become a paramartha satya, an individual with absolute perfect glory. Yes? Question? Don't forget your being. When somebody is attacked by their own egos, we have to remember our being, our own God. Because remember that He is the one that has the light. Work against the darkness, your own ego. Say, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Etc. That's the prayer of the Lord. The best that you can do when you are being attacked by your own defects, vices, errors, your own demons. Do you have another question? Here.
You said that 12 hours we should memorize their meetings. Are they going to be posted on the website?
They're already there. There are the 12 hours of Apollonius are in the back of the book of Tarot and Kabbalah. The master talks about that after the world of Malkut. It's a good question in order to remind you something here. Listen. The 12 hours of Apollonius start in Malkut. Because it's in Malkut where we walk. First, the master explains all the 10 Sephiroth, and when reaching Malkut, he starts the first hour. Then the other arcanum, which is the 11th, is the second hour. And likewise, until reaching all the 22 arcana. So, of course, in there you find the meaning in synthesis of every hour. But remember that you can extend that hour if you meditate in each one, because every hour has its own meaning. And the meaning that is given in the books are in synthesis. But remember this, don't forget this. The meaning of the hour depends on your own glory, or the way in which the sun shines within you. That's the hour that you need. If you want to enter, of course, in the higher hours of the Pistis Sophia, which are the 12 repentances, well, you need to be a bodhisattva. Another question?
There is also the Aim that you didn't talk about, right? At the very top. Well, that means that symbolizes the 13 hour or 36?
The Master Samael on the Or explains that beyond the Ein Sof is the Ein, yeah, the 13th Ein, which is 13, death, complete destruction of the ego. That's the hour of liberation. To enter into that hour is the goal of every initiate. Usually, every initiate reaches the 12th and then get there. To reach the 13th hour is something that few initiates can reach. In relation, of course, with self-realization. Because every time that you disintegrate an ego and pass beyond the 12th hour, you enter into the 13th, which is death. And then you enter into a new sunrise. This is what we have to understand. Yes?
With the terms you're familiar with, does it make sense to say that those in bodies are considered Westerners?
In bodies? What bodies? Consider,
down at the bottom,
oh yeah, because Malkut is the West, so the bodies are Westerners, yeah, of course. It means that all the inhabitants of this planet Earth, their bodies are Westerners. We had to be a body of the Sun of the East, in other words, a body of Israel, according to the Bible. Then you have to reach your heart, that's the East, Israel. That's the meaning of Israel in the Bible, the East, Tifereth. That's why all the work that you do in yourself is a work in order to liberate Israel from the West. Because Israel right now is in the West, is in Egypt, Mizrahim, in slavery. That is all the particles of God that we have are bottled up within our own physical body. Sins, defects, vices, errors. Those parts of God are called Israel, in Israel. I wish you a good sunrise. There is no lecture for tomorrow. For 2 weeks. For 2 weeks. Which one? July the 10th. July the 10th is the next lecture. Ευχαριστώ, παρακαλώ.
To learn more about what you learned in this lecture, we invite you to explore the books published by Glorian Publishing, available from booksellers worldwide. You may also be interested in online courses or upcoming retreats, all of which you can learn about at GnosticTeachings.org. All of this has been made possible by the financial support of listeners like you. Will you help others to benefit from this knowledge? Most spiritual schools recommend a donation of $10 to $20 per lecture. Every donation helps. Make a donation now at GnosticTeachings.org. Thank you. May all beings be happy.